make.
Now, in my studio, I would very carefully have closed my bucket of gel before I moved on to the other stages. This is the downside to talking, you know. I only have so much brain capacity, so I will.
And then obviously, you don't transport these while they're drying. You just leave them wherever you are.
Or we transport them. Oshawa. Yeah, we'll be transporting.
Oh, you just have amazing ways of doing that, I'm sure. You have special.
The main thing, you know, what I advise students to do is just to get boxes that have lips, you know, because this is quite heavy, and it's not a canvas, but you know, there's a way you can stack canvases with strips of cardboard, right, and then you can transport it, but that wouldn't work with something that weighs pounds, or cardboard would just crumple, and then you'd have a nice sandwich, right? So, so this just needs patient care, and we have plastic with us. And you know, if in the transporting something comes and interferes with this, then I will just dream up ways of working that. So I can soften the paint up with alcohol gel, or I can layer on top, or something like that.
I do like how you sign these.
On the sides? Yeah.
Very much.
Well, I mean, you know, you look at stuff like this and you can't really sign it on the front. It's just not. So it's signed with my signature on the back and with my last name on the side.
But I really like that.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I did put some thought into it, so I'm glad you liked it. Could I possibly get some more water, Cal? Would you mind getting me some more? And I have another panel that I brought with me. So you've seen it around it now.
Do you make these panels or do you buy them?
I buy them, yeah. Sometimes I have them custom made. I want lots or I want special sizes, but I'm also a creature of convenience and I'll just hop over to the Curry's or Above Ground or wherever and
they're pretty pick common.
Them
up.
Yeah. And I love them. You know, I had a series many years ago called Boxed In where I was doing a lot of boxed in figures, one figure with some kind of implied or explicit containment, and so these wood panels were awesome for that. Mm-hmm. I just turned it over and looked at it. It had this lovely imprint from the manufacturer, and I thought, I have to put a figure in there. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Okay, so this is all being improvised in front of you. I didn't pre-plan any of the things except for preparing the ground. So I thought on this one I would do something along the lines of one of the radials or one of the radiants. So the little 4-inchers that are beside the cabinet and the 6-inchers that are on behind Helen Call and underneath those two, that pair, those are radiants, as is the big one facing outside. They're really related to those two, the pair there that are called spin 2 and spin 3. But they're also related to the radials. So one of the things all of them have in common is the use of squeegees.
Even these?
Yes.
They all use squeegees.
They all use squeegees. Not exclusively, it depends, right? So, but squeegees are, you know, you can get to know any tool and find what it's capable of. And I think, I don't know if it relates to, it definitely relates to my approach to drawing, which is, I'll use plenty of traditional tools. I mean, how traditional is charcoal, right? Like the first drawing tool, but to find lots of ways of working with it to see what it can do, and to pick things sometimes that do something that I like, but to maybe overcome its limitations. Cal, could you do something for me? Behind Paul is the red and green gradient.
Yep.
You could just get that out and pass it around.
Yep.
You can just hold it from the bottom as we pass it around. Just look, it is a very pure form of this because I stopped at one color application because it was doing everything I needed it to do. I didn't need more color to make it better. So finding ways of working with the squeegee, both to add, both. I don't know, what's the three equivalent to both? To add, to move, and to remove paint. And what's amazing is it can actually get, depending on the blade, some blades are quite stiff, but this is quite a Dollarama, I've got to tell you, quite a sensitive blade, and it has a really fine edge. And so it's amazing what you can actually do with it. Also, who here has any of these catalyst wedges?
Yeah.
No? Oh, pass this around.
Oh, I like it already.
Yeah. It's made by Princeton, I believe is the
company. Can I get a
shot? And they're made of silicone. They're based on the baking tools.
Isn't silicone a wonderful substance?
It's so delicious. You know, I said I'm a really tactile
yeah.
person, so I love my silicone spatulas.
Yes.
I love
yeah.
Thank you. This will be fun. Feel it. Okay. Alizarin crimson hue. I guess it's there.
Wow, it doesn't look like the oil version.
Doesn't look like what?
Doesn't look like the oil version.
No.
The alizarin crimson looks quite different in oil.
Ah. Another crimson. This is naphtha. Always have wet as well as dry rags, especially for blade tools. Actually, it's one of the things. If you try painting with squeegees yourself, make sure you have wet and dry rags around because you need to not let the paint dry on the blade. Or it would be a lot of work.
They're only a buck.
Pardon me?
Luckily they're only a buck.
Yeah.
Or two.
Yeah. It's just a shame.
Yeah.
Throw it out. Throw it out for lack of a wet cloth, right? Yeah. Quite enough paint there. See my nice tidy apron?
Yeah, I noticed that.
I wrote this out for you.
Very, very tidy.
I didn't bring the one that's stiff with paint, you know?
Well, I'm impressed that the paint hasn't managed to crawl up yet.
Yeah.
It's early days yet, though.
Early days, yeah, who knows? Yeah.
Tim usually wears it with pride.
I do.
Yeah, I have my painting coat. It's covered.
Oh, yeah, is that the lab coat?
No, no, mine's down.
Oh, wow.
Her studio's very cold.
That's hard.
It's cold, yeah.
I have three of those.
Yeah.
And then sometimes I'll wear an electric blanket over that, it's perfect.
Wow, that is cold.
Oh, yeah, my studio's freezing.
At least I have one.
Yeah.
That's what I'm grateful for, yeah.
Hard to do this in your house, you know, and, well, I suppose it's easier.
That's what I do.
You do it in your
house? Most of our house is
No, we
studio.
Live in our studio.
You live in
our
studio.
Oh, wait, that was
Most of our house is studio, so. That would be a good idea, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a sad thing happen where I'd just gotten a new down winter coat. And a week later, I'm carrying a wet painting and a gust of wind plasters it against part of my coat.
So it became your painting coat.
It was a sad
It's a law, though, if you're transporting canvas, 60 kilometer an hour winds.
Right? Yeah. They'll come out of nowhere.
It never fails.
They'll come out of
take
nowhere.
You down show and
yeah.
Yeah.
You're not adding any gloss or anything to it.
I'm not adding any to this. I'm not putting a bed of this. So, certainly some of these paintings have a gel base. For example, these sponge sheen, the three sponge sheen ones that use graphite acrylic paint, which is graphite powder embedded in acrylic, they had a gel texture base applied with the squeegee first and then dried, and then the paint was stumbled against the texture. So I didn't bring a ruler, so I'm just going to eyeball this. If I brought longer squeegees, I could intentionally do it off-center. I'll just eyeball it. Okay. See how it wants to blobs want to fall off. So if you look at that, you can see I'm playing with pressure to get certain things. Now, I'll just tune up the amount of paint that's there.
Does it have a tendency to fall off, the paint?
Oh, it wants to fall off, absolutely.
Yeah.
The sheer weight, it's just balancing on a really skinny little edge, so it's kind of like a little kid on skates. It's just waiting to fall. Okay, that
that's
was
like
my
how I feel pain.
My warm up, yes, that's right. My warm up, I'm just trying to figure out how to. There, I think somewhere in there is the sweet spot for me. This one, I think I'm going to play with a little bit more. Like the Egon Schiele of the squeegee.
So I noticed that not fairly level surface to work with.
Yeah, I have a long table I work on normally.
Yeah, I would find that tipping is unsettling.
It's all something to adapt to, right? It's like in life drawing when they make you draw with your left hand, your wrong hand, I should say, or with your, you know, foot or whatever. Yeah, there's an idea.
Watch out, Kim's next class.
Yeah, that's right. I've only got a couple of weeks left. I'm gonna
keep them on their toes.
Draw with your toes. Maybe do that yet.
She'll be able to say yes after next week.
Repeat and vary, right? That's kind of the part of this. Not that the paint would allow me to make anything look too identical.
When I was trying this out at home, I used my basics.
Yep.
Out of the tube, so
yep,
that I could just squeeze it on like tube.
Absolutely.
Paste.
Yep.
I still need a nest, but
no, it's simpler than trying to do it from the.
But I couldn't mix the paints. They had to be that color.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. I get some white. The one thing I have muscles for. Opening paint.
I wouldn't be able to open my paint without pliers.
Upon occasion.
You're dealing with tubes, right?
Yeah, and really I have some Grumbecker paints, so they're like really old.
Yeah.
Best colors ever though.
Yeah. Yeah, I remember when I worked with Grumbecker. My hair falls out really a lot, so I'm always having to pick hair out of palettes and off brushes. So I'm like, okay.
Keep it in. That's that extra texture
thing.
Yeah. Jackson Pollock, didn't you need all that kind of stuff in?
Save my
turd, didn't you?
Save my clippings and.
Too.
I just had haircuts.
Personal touch.
That's right. My DNA, right?
Yes.
In the painting.
No, I remember it was Poussin. He put his thumbprint in the grounds that made the. It's a very famous painting. It's called The Wheel of Time.
Right.
And in the background of that painting, his thumbprint is in all the grounds that prepare the painting. Yeah, it's very cool.
Yeah. We such use dog fur.
So why aren't you using the medium when you do this? You want to keep the. You don't need to, or if you need to.
Yeah, I don't need to. If I wanted to alter the sheen, I certainly could, or if I wanted to be working with a glaze instead, absolutely. Because I'm working with, if I were working more fluidly and I was adding water, then I'd probably add a bit of medium in order to...
Here it's more about pigment.
Yeah, and the pure paint, you know, it'll, I'm interested, I think if you look closely at the paintings, you'll see differences in the sheen of different colors on it. I don't do a varnish to unite the finish, and because I'm interested in the differences between them. And so that's another reason I would just do it like this. Let me just add a little bit of that. Oh, this color looks so nice next to the cadmium orange, I have to say. The other reason I paint, right?
Beautiful, warm, cool. It's really nice.
See if it works against the lime, but I'm all for trying. Yeah, it will end up looking very low key. It's very low chroma. That's good because I'm not going to hit it with orange. So. Shorter radius one because I want to have cover a larger area, I think, this stroke. Let's see. See whether that was a good idea or not. Veils like a,
oh, it's gorgeous.
Like a sheer curtain, right?
Just beautiful. I would have never thought of putting those two colors together. It's lovely.
Yeah, I have I don't know how many of you are familiar with Brian Smith at all. He's a figure painter.
I saw a picture.
Did you really?
I bumped into him at the AGO, yeah.
Awesome. He's a old friend, and he was also a graphic designer, so we have that in common. And you know, he loves beautiful color schemes. That's what he's after. Really, color schemes that just feel beautiful and harmonious. They really work. And sometimes I show. He sees stuff of mine, and you can see him wince. Because my response to my design background is, I spent all those years developing harmonious color schemes. I want something with a bit of edge. I want something with a surprise. Sometimes it means that there's real tension in the color scheme. Sometimes it just means that there's just a little, ooh. Didn't expect that in, right?
Yeah.
And so that's the game I like to play, because I get what you're saying, and I'm quite pleased with that color.
Oh,
I think it's working nicely. So that's part of the fun of it for me. So it means I take some flyers sometimes, but that I get pleasure out of taking some flyers, and some of them don't work, and some of them work surprisingly well, so that makes totally worthwhile. And even when they don't work, you learn something, right? You know, you look at it and you realize, oh, but if I'd made it darker or if I'd made it lower intensity, then it would have worked fine. You know, it's just that it's too whatever. And that's why it didn't work that
fine. Can you take the paint off these and start over again? Or you just paint over them?
I just paint over them. If there were really high peaks that I wanted to eliminate, I could soften and scrape. Or if it's not a cadmium, then I could sand, you know, coarse sand. I wouldn't do that with cadmium.
Kim, could you talk a little bit about your color diary? Because I think the work in the color diary informs these paintings.
It does. It does, and even what I was just talking about. So several years ago, I forget how long ago exactly, I started an almost daily practice called my color diary, and my intention, first I'm just going to decide what I'm doing with this load of paint. That's more stable. So it was a set size of watercolor paper I taped to a board, and every day it was very rigid. It wasn't about painting per se. It was I just do stripes applied with a knife of mixed colors, and I would start with one color or a pair of colors, or in one case I remember saying, I'm not a landscape painter, so I don't mix enough greens. I don't get enough experience with greens. So I just did greens. And it took me like two and a half hours to paint this little color diary because I had so many skinny stripes of so many kinds of green. Amazing how long it took. So I have 125 of these. And, you know, one day I woke up and I said, I'm going to start with the color of this peanut butter. So I put that on, which necessarily meant I had to do jam. And then I went from there. And sometimes I work with colors I've never worked with, and I mix them into every color, or I purposely pushed the color, you know, what am I putting in the same painting, you know, together, same swatch of my diary together. Let's put some weird stuff and see if I can make a working color scheme. And then the other thing I did was, when I started out, I had certain color habits and certain color prejudices. And by the time I was done, you know, I think we go through different color habits at different times anyway, but other than that, I got rid of my avoidance of pink. So now pink shows up whenever it's needed. I love pink in a painting. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't necessarily wear it. It's not, this is more me than a pink. Mm-hmm. But I love it in painting, because without it, it's like you're eliminating a whole section of the piano keyboard and trying to play your music. So so that was a very, very interesting project, and it just occurred to me to do. And I'm so grateful I did it. Responsive, right? So I'm manipulating the paint. So sometimes I'm doing like this, I'm wobbling it, I'm pressing, I'm lifting. Other times I'm almost printmaking with the squeegee. And other times I'm sculpting with it. So it's a very interesting, why don't I try this one just for fun? And I'll use it for the orange. It'll be really fun to layer a bit of orange on that pale violet, but I won't be able to yet. So I will clean this off. Really need to get that comb in the water. Everything else will survive, but I don't want to have to clean that comb. Glorious way. Okay. So even when I was painting the big version of this in the window, I just had a starting point. First of all, I stained the panel white transparently so that you could still see the wood grain and so that it wouldn't be pure white feeling. And I forget what colors I started with, but I think I started with some tinted color so that it would be not too strong a statement right at the beginning. And then I built up stronger color not long after that. But as I say, I have the basic idea of doing using the squeegee, using the radial form, and my interest in layering up porous color, playing with different kinds of color combinations and mixing, and then it's just a jazz improvisation beyond that, and which draws on my experience with color and paint and my interests also. Things.
You always match the color of the squeegee to the base color.
As often as I can. It's like my lips and my apron.